بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this opportunity to continue our lessons in Aqidah Sanusiyah, and we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with the understanding, and Allah bless us with the forgiveness and guidance, and we pray that Allah protect us from all difficulties, trials and tribulations in dunya and akhirah, and make us among those and who are close to Him, among those who are blessed and with iman and taqwa. And may Allah bless us with Husn Khatima and guide us to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam Yawm al-Qiyamah. Ameen Ya Rabb al-Alameen. In our last lesson, yani 2 weeks ago, we were speaking about the sifat salbiya, yani the negating attributes. And we have come to speak about the attribute of mukhalafatuhu lil hawadith, which means any that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not any the same as the contingent beings. So by now any all of you who have followed in this class knows any the meaning of contingent. When we say contingent, it is understood. So in Arabic, we call it hadith. Contingent in English, and it refers to hadith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mukhalafatuhu lil hawadith. Hawadith is the plural of hadith. So we say Allah is not the same as contingent beings. What is the meaning of contingent beings? It is basically something that has no afan, that has a beginning. Anything that has a beginning in its existence is contingent. Meaning its existence is preceded by non-existence. This is the meaning of contingent. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not the same as the hawadith, yani the contingent beings. So this is what we spoke about in our last lesson. And we have come into speaking about the dalil behind this particular attribute. And the author spoke about Surah Al-Ikhlas. One of the evidence that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not the same as the contingent beings is Surah Al-Ikhlas, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ. Yani nothing is like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing from the creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I spoke about a very important principle in Aqidah that I mentioned, that it is good that if you memorize. It is a saying, and it says, "Kullu ma khatara fi balik, fallahu khilafu dhalik." Kullu ma khatara fi balik, fallahu khilafu dhalik. And this is one of the, what you call it, important and principles in Aqidah. Aqidah Ahlu Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And if we say that anything that comes into your mind about Allah, Allah is not like that. And it is impossible. You straight away, you negate. Anything that comes into your mind that Allah is like this, fallahu khilafu dhalik. And Allah is not like that. Clear, inshallah. طيب, this is based on the verse in the Quran, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. Nothing is like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ. This is dalil. So that's why our ulama come with this principle. كُلُّ مَا خَطَرَ فِي بَالِكَ فَاللَّهُ خِلَافُ ذَلِكَ. And this is basically the meaning of مُخَالَفَةُ لِلْحَوَادِثِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not the same as the contingent beings. So I believe we have spoken everything in this attribute, correct? No? We get all the way, I think we stop at Qiyamuhu binafs. This is where we stop, correct? No? We have covered Mukhalafatul Hawadith in our last lesson. Correct? No? So now, inshallah ta'ala, we speak about the next sifat of Salbiyah. That is Qiyamuhu binafs. Qiyamuhu binafs. So it is translated as self-subsistence. Yani it is a self and a subsistence attribute. And this is any part of sifat salbiyah, the negating any attributes. So basically, in translation, when we say self, and subsistence, any meaning, Allah is not in need of anything. Yani inshallah, it has a meaning. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who created everything into existence, He is not in need of anything. He said on His own, not in need. Whereas all of us, we are in need, correct? Right? We are in need of food and drink. Yani if you are deprived of your food and drink and for 3 days, you might pass away. Correct? Right? We are in need of oxygen. If insan is deprived of oxygen, how many minutes can pass away? 10 minutes maybe. I think so. Or even 5 minutes. Some people, they have difficulty in breathing. In 5 minutes, no oxygen, and they can pass away. So it shows how weak an insan. Likewise, any animals. Animals need to oxygen to sustain, food and drink. The vegetation, they are in need of sunlight to sustain. If there is no sun, no sunlight, no vegetation can exist on the face of this earth. And we are in need of water, and so on and so forth. And we are constantly in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Constantly in need of something else. Because we do not stand on our own. We are fuqara, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned. Ya ayuhan nas antumul fuqara. O insan, all of you are fuqara. All of you are in need. Because you do not possess anything. Wallahu huwal ghaniyul hamid. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is not in need. This is the meaning of qiyamuhu bin nafs. Inshallah. Tamam. But if you study any aqidah, it's more than that. And this is just basically translation and to understand meaning of the term. So in short, any meaning of term, when we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala possess the attribute of qiyamuhu bin nafs, meaning He is not in need of anything. He is not in need of anything. That is why it is part of sifat salbiyah. Because one thing about sifat salbiyah, to define sifat salbiyah, it start of any negative particle. And if you say Allah is not in need of anything. Mukhalafatul al-hawadis, Allah is not the same as contingent beings. Al-qidam, Allah has no beginning. Al-baqa, Allah has no ending. So all these attributes, it starts with negative any particle. So that is why it's called salbiyah. Because the meaning of self is negative. So we are negating impossibilities to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the meaning of sifat salbiyah. So now inshallah, we'll read what the author is saying. He says, self-subsistence is negation of having need for a locus, mahal, or a determiner, mukhassis. So now anyway, explain. These are some terminologies in Tawheed. The meaning of qiyamuhu bin nafs, the deeper meaning of qiyamuhu bin nafs, there are two things. Number one, we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need of mahal. Allah is not in need of a place. Or not in need of something to dwell in. This point number one. Number two, Allah is not in need of something which we term as mukhassis in the Arabic language. Mukhassis, if I were to translate this term, I will say something that specifies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need of something else to specify Him, to specify His existence, or to specify His attributes. In order for you to understand the second part, you have to understand the definition of irada. For those who have learned Kharida Bahiyya, for example. If I were to ask what is the definition of sifat irada? Anyone who memorized? Sifat irada. This is the thing. I would advise when you study attributes, try your best to memorize definition. If a person asks you what is qudra, and if you really have studied any tawheed, at least you should know the definition. Even if you don't know in Arabic, you can explain in English. So if a person asks you what is the meaning of the attribute of irada of Allah, what do you say? And if a person say irada, it means will. It's not what you meant. This is not a definition. This is a translation. There is a difference between translation and definition. Memorizing any translations will not get you anywhere. You just say, okay, irada is a will. Kudra is a power. This is just in translation. But when you speak about ta'rif, if a person asks you, what is irada? You say, sifatun azaliyatun. Tukhassisul mumkina. This is an attribute that is azali, that has no beginning, that is specifying something that is mumkin. Biba'di ma yajuzu alayhi. Min ijadin wa i'damin. Yani to what you call specifying. A particular mumkin from existence or non-existence. Or pertaining any to the place and pertaining any to the quantity. This is the meaning of irada. So when we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need any of a mukhassis, meaning He is not in need any of something else, any to specify His existence or to specify His non-existence or to specify His attributes. This is impossible any for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So qiyamuhu ayni bin nafsini has two meaning. Number one, Allah is not in need of mahal. I will speak about this inshallah. Later inshallah we will speak into more detail. Number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need any of a place any to reside in. Number two, Allah is not in need of something else any to specify Him. So for example, now we use any example any of ourselves, an insan. We say that we are an effect of the specification of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the last time when we speak about the attributes of Allah in the Khalid al-Bahiyya, we say that we are the effect of the specification of Allah. Meaning what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who specifies your existence. When you will be born. Some of us are born in the year 1982. Some of us 1983, 1984, 85. Who is the one who specifies whether you are born in this year or that year? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This meaning of taqsis. Clear inshallah? And Allah specifies in your existence that you will be in existence at a particular time. That your skin color will be brown. That you will not be a white person. Some people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them as a black person. And Allah specifies the place. Some of us are born in Singapore. Some of us, what you call it, some people are born in the Middle East or in India or in Europe and so on. Who is the one who specifies where you are born? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the meaning of taqsis. And this specification is qadim, azali. That is why when we speak about the irada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we say sifatun azaliyatun tukhassisul mumkina. So it is sifatun azaliya. It is azali, meaning has no beginning. Yani before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created you, Allah has specified everything for you. When you be born, where you be born, what are your characteristics and what are your attributes? What is your height and your what you call it and your skin color and your characteristics and so on and so forth. All of us, we have different characteristics. Now, any people found out that even our thumbprint is not the same. All of us, we have a different set of thumbprint. And who is the one who specifies? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the meaning of takhassis. So mukhassis is the thing that specifies. So here when we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need of mukhassis, meaning He is not in need of something to determine His existence. Impossible. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is qadim, He has no beginning. So it is impossible that something other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specifies the existence of Allah. When the existence of something is specified, meaning it has a beginning. Clear inshallah? What I'm saying requires some ponderance. Something that is specified, the existence of something when it is specified, it means that it has a beginning. It means it has a beginning. That is why when you speak about the irada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we say irada is only related to the mumkin, to the contingent beings. It is not related to the wajibat, it is not related to the mustahilat. Meaning it's not related to the absolute and the impossible. It is only related to the possible beings, the mumkinat, the mumkin. Because why? Because the effect of taqsis is only applicable to something that has a beginning. So when we say that a particular thing is, the existence of a particular thing is specified, meaning it has a beginning. Otherwise, how can it be specified? How can the existence of a particular being be specified if it has no beginning? Does it make sense or doesn't make sense? Is it clear, inshallah? Huh? Can we ponder? When we say the existence of a particular being is specified, meaning what? Meaning it has a beginning. Correct or not? If it has not, if it has not a beginning, if there is no beginning in a particular thing, if it's qadim, then the existence, and it cannot be specified. Because it has no beginning, it is always in existence. How can it be the existence and it be specified? Specification of existence and meaning when this particular being and it will be in existence. That's the meaning of takhsis. Can Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be, his existence be specified? Now this is the meaning that we are saying. It is impossible that the existence and of Allah be specified. Because if the existence and of Allah is specified, meaning it has a beginning, and this is impossible, mustahil. This is what anyway we spoke any about, the attribute of Al-Qidam. That Allah has no beginning. Other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a beginning. So qiyamuhu bin nafs, Allah does not reside any in a place. So it is wajib any upon us any to negate places to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning Allah any does not dwell in a place. We cannot any be imagining any that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth, is indeed any of something else to reside in. This is impossible. Because the moment that you say Allah is in need any of a place, meaning He is in need any of something else. And Allah mentioned in the Quran, Wallahu al-Ghani. Allah is not in need. So there is a contradiction to the Quran. That is why our scholars, some of our scholars of Ahlul Sunnah, mentioned that those any who say that Allah is in need any of a place, they are apostates. Some any of the Ahlul Sunnah. Why? Because clearly you are going against any of the Quran. The Quran any mentioned Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need of anything. But the moment you see Allah is in need of something, then there is a problem. Problem in aqidah. Big problem, it's not a small problem, and it's not like some people, they thought that it is just the same as a woman touching a man and in skin to skin, just wudu becomes invalid. No, it's not the same. When it comes to fiqh, we have differences. But when it comes to things on the attribution of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like this issue, there is no khilaf between Ahlul Sunnah. So these are the things that we have to understand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need. Clearly in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Allah is not in need any of a place to reside in. Point number one, I repeat again, so that inshallah it becomes clear inshallah. Sometimes I like to repeat some of these things. Number one, Allah is not in need any of a place to reside in. Please ignore that. This is the meaning of qiyamuhu binafs. Number two, Allah is not in need of a mukhassis. That's what I mentioned earlier. Can you memorize this? Allah is not in need of a mukhassis. I use the term mukhassis. So that inshallah we remember this term, any mukhassis. Because to translate, any we can say the thing that specifies, or here the translator is using what? A determiner. Determiner. Any for your information. He's basically any translating the word mukhassis. But when I say mukhassis, I hope any is clear. I explained earlier about the meaning of mukhassis, and it's something that specifies. Nothing any specifies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is one who specifies everything. Correct or not? Every existence, everything that exists that has a beginning, makhluk, is specified by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yani in terms of his existence, in terms of his non-existence, in terms of his attributes, and so forth, and so forth. And the specification, the taqsis of Allah is qadim. Clear? Yani before Allah created you, Allah has already specified everything. When you are going to be born, when you are going to die. And Allah has specified even your actions, what you will be doing, has already been specified. That our coming to Masjid Abdul Ghazal tonight also has been specified by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything that happens, it is specified by Allah. This is the meaning of the irada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is mukhassis. Allah is the one who specifies. Not being specified upon. Nothing can specify Allah, but Allah is the one who specifies everything. So now we read what the author is saying. No, he said self that is subsistence is negation of having need for a locus. Locus mahal meaning yani basically it is a place anywhere, a place to reside in. Like for example, then our bodies. Inside any our bodies any there is a soul. So the soul any is in need any of our bodies need to reside in. Correct or not? So this, our bodies is called locus. Mahal. a place anywhere the soul reside. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not any in need any of something to reside in. Common sense, huh? I mean, this is what you call it. Wallahu a'lam, maybe you don't use the word common sense, but this is something any that is clear, inshallah. All of us, any Muslims, any we believe that Allah, what you call it, does not reside any in something. Because you need to believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is residing any in something. Later any daughter any will say, what is any the result any of that saying? So not having a locus mahal or a determiner. So he translates any mukhassis as a determiner. So just take note the meaning any of mukhassis. Then he mentioned he, the glorified, is not in need of a locus in which to subsist. As an attribute subsists within that which is described as sifa fil mawsuf. Now he gave any this example. As sifa fil mawsuf. He is saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he is not in need any of something to reside in, like the attributes sifa that is in need any of a body any to reside. Yani for example, any look at our attributes. Look at the attributes any of insan. We look any at a person, we understand that this person possesses knowledge. This person possesses knowledge. So knowledge any is an attribute. Knowledge any by itself any cannot stand. This knowledge cannot stand. So the knowledge any is in need any of something any to reside in. So if you look any at a person, you see this person and he is knowledgeable and you understand that his knowledge is an attribute, sifa. Sifa is something that cannot stand on its own, correct or not? Can your knowledge stand on its own? Meaning, is there such thing any as knowledge without a person? Yani, meaning you see, you look at something that is knowledge. Is there such thing? There's no such thing because knowledge any is an attribute. And attribute any always stand any in a body of a person. This we are just speaking any about insan. I'm just giving an example of insan. Simple example and so that we can understand. So my knowledge is an attribute that is within me. So this is the meaning any of the knowledge any is within the body. The attribute is within the body. This is any the meaning any of residing within, in it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yani, now any the author is saying any is not what you call it inside any something. Like the sifa and the mawsuf. We cannot any be imagining that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is present inside a particular being. This is what he basically is saying. And then he gave any the example of the Nasara. The Nasara need to believe that Allah is inside Isa alayhi salam. This is an example. This is impossible for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Correct or not? The Nasara, what do they say? They say Isa alayhi salam, Nabi Isa alayhi salam, and he is a God. That God and he has entered into his body. That he is a man. But God and he has entered inside him. So he is God. So this is a meaning any of Na'uz billah min dhalik, any God and he enter into something. In Arabic any we call it hulul. We have the term al-hulul. Al-hulul any meaning Na'uz billah min dhalik, it is the belief that God enter into a being. Just like earlier any we mentioned any that the knowledge any of a person is within that person. Can I hope it's clear, inshallah. Huh? So now any we are saying it is impossible for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah any does not, and look at the word anyway, he said. Allah is not in need of a locus in which to subsist. Any subsist, any meaning any to reside. To be in. So it's not any in need any of a place or something that he reside in. Clear, inshallah. Then he gave the example. As an attribute subsists within that which is described. The example I gave is myself. My knowledge, yani, is within me, inside me. So this is the example. Because knowledge itself, any cannot stand on its own. Knowledge any is in need any of something else, any to subsist. So we cannot any be saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in need any of a locus. to subsist in, or a place they need to subsist in. This is impossible any for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As was claimed by the Christians and the Bartiniya. Then he gave any of the examples of two any groups any of people. The Christians any and the Bartiniya. The first speaks any about God any is inside the makhluk. That Allah is inside Isa alayhi salam. So we mentioned al-khulul. Yani if a Muslim any believe that Allah is inside someone, what happens? Can he be considered a Muslim? If a Muslim and he believe in the Batiniya, then he gave an example Batiniya. You know what's Batiniya? Batiniya is a sect in Islam, but of course they are apostates. They believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is inside Ali bin Abi Talib. Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib. They believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is inside who? Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib. So they are apostates in reality. Because the moment any a Muslim believe that Allah is inside a person, then he is not any Muslim. Because why? Because any, that's what we mentioned any, a person any go against any many verses in the Quran. Not only any he will say, for example, Allah is in need of a place any to reside, but also any he says that Allah any is like any the person. And this is any people who are called Al-Batiniya. And it is sect in Shia. But not all Shia believes any like that. Most of the Shia say they do not say that Allah is Isa Ali. No. Most of them, no. But this sect of Batiniya, they are basically minority within the Shia. That even any the majority Shia say they do not regard them any Shia. Because they are so extreme and to such an extent they are loved to Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib. They say that Allah is in Ali, is in Ali. Just like the Nasara believes that Allah is in Isa alayhi salam, and the Batiniya says Allah is in Sayyidina Ali bin Abi Talib. So they are basically cannot be considered any within the belief any within Islam. Because they have done any act any of apostasy. And there are differences in amongst the ulama in this issue. The moment a person says Allah is in something, then what you call it he is, what you call it an apostate. Then he said there is an animus consensus that whoever believes that Allah is in something is a disbeliever. So there is ijma. Maybe you write this down. The word here is al-ijma. Al-ijma, yani we say scholarly consensus. Meaning there are no differences within the scholars of Islam. That the moment a Muslim believes that Allah is in something, automatically he becomes a disbeliever. He is in need to recite kalimah shahada. Again. And to believe any in the correct any belief that Allah yani is not in need of anything and does not reside in anything. Similarly, believing in indwelling and union. Now we have some terminologies. So we have any this terminology where it is translated as indwelling. So you put down there in brackets holul. Those of you who have the book, put there holul. H-U-L-U-L. The translation is indwelling. The example is what we mentioned earlier. They believe in it that Allah is in something, but not necessarily in a person. See, some people they believe that God and is inside the stone. Some people and believe in it that God is inside a particular idol. And if you ask any some people, for example, why you worship this idol, they said, I'm not worshipping the idol, but I'm worshipping God who's inside the idol. So they believe in this indwelling, it is holul. Many religions other than Islam, they believe in such things. And some religion and they believe, for example, sometimes God is here, sometimes God is there. So you find them sometimes going here and going there. You ask them, why you go here and go there? Because say this particular time, God is here. And next month, you'll be there. So they will go into places and places. Because their belief is that God and he can move any from one place and into another place. Some religion and believe that you can call God. And if you have an idol, you call upon God and God will be inside that idol. So they believe and they pray to the idol because they believe that at this particular moment, God is inside. But in reality, the Quran speaks about this, subhanAllah. The Quran says that they are لَكِنْ يَعْبُدُونَ الْجِنِ Allah said. They are basically worshipping the jinn. The jinn is tricking them. The jinn, what you call it, does something and they believe that this is God and himself. But actually, it's not God, it's the jinn. So they worship any idols. Because any of these illusions any that they possess. But this particular belief any is called al-khulul. That's what we mentioned. The belief any of indwelling. that God in is in isn't something, whether it is in a person or whether it is in a, what you call it, in something that is not alive. No. And then the second one we have, union. So write this down. It is called ittihad. Ittihad. So we have hulul and ittihad. These are two different terminologies. Hulul, as what we mentioned, the belief that God is in something. This is called indwelling, hulul. There is another term that is called ittihad. There are people who believe in ittihad. For example, they say that Allah is a universe and universe is Allah. They believe in it that Allah and the universe is one. That Allah is inside everything. This is worse. Correct, no? Yani they believe that the universe and that you see, the universe, everything and that you see around you is God. This is the belief any of al-ittihad, that God and universe is one, because the meaning of ittihad is oneness. So their belief any is that God and the universe is God and the universe any is one. This is any day belief any of ittihad. So there is a bit of similarity between hulul and ittihad. What is the similar thing? Basically the similar thing any is hulul, any speaks any about God any being inside something, meaning it comes to something. Ittihad meaning God and something is the same. God and something is the same. That is why in our aqidah, it is not permissible to say that God is everywhere. Because what you call it, the belief of ittihad is what they say. And if you ask them, where is God? They say God and is in everywhere. Can you see? Say God is in everywhere, meaning everywhere any you turn to, there is God. But they take the literal meaning. Literal meaning any is ittihad. But metaphorically, when we say Allah is everywhere, meaning Allah knows everything. It does not mean any that the essence of Allah is everywhere. But it means any that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything that happens everywhere. Clear? Because the Quran any mentioned, وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. Allah is with you wherever you go. Meaning is Allah knows what you are doing. Not any it means that the essence of Allah is beside you every time. We cannot be taking any of this meaning literally, because the Quran is what I mentioned many a times. The Quran is full of metaphorical meanings. That is why our scholars have mentioned, if a person does not know Arabic language, it is not permissible for him to speak on the Quran, to do tafsir of the Quran, because the Quran is full of majaz. To understand majaz, you have to understand, you have to have a common Arabic language. Then you can understand the metaphorical meanings any within the Quran. You cannot any just by reading any translations, because translations give you literal meanings. You are in need any to read tafsir of the scholars of tafsir to understand some verses. Because you have to understand, not all verses in the Quran easy to understand. There are some verses in the Quran easy. For example, Allah said in the Quran, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu kutiba alaykumus siyam. O believers, fasting has been made compulsory upon you. It's easy and everybody and can understand. Even an Arab Bedouin also can understand. Okay, no? When Allah said, Wa aqimu salata wa atu zakah, perform the prayer, give zakah, mashallah, everybody and can understand. But when comes into Wallahu ma'akum aynama kuntum, now what you call it, you are in need to relax. You need to ponder and ask, because there is a metaphorical meanings behind. Yadullahi fawqa aydihim. Bal yadahu mabsutatan. All these are mutashabihat. This part of the Quran which is difficult for people to understand. Even the scholars in the Salaf, they say, Wallahu alam bi biradi. Allah knows best. Alif la mim. This is what same thing they say. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. Wallahu alam. Some of scholars even go to that direction because to play safe. And they do not want any the common people any to busy themselves any with all these things, that will make them confused. So they say it's better you concentrate on the verses of fiqh, on the verses that pertain to fasting, verses pertaining to hajj, and so on and so forth. So many verses in the Quran are based on majaz and mutashabihat, that we must be careful. We are in need of interpretation of the ulama to understand, and we have to take time to ponder. If we have some confusion, then we have to be careful. So these are so many of the things, what you call it, pertaining mainly to some things. So it says, similarly, believing is in indwelling and union, which is when two things becomes one. Two things and it becomes one, is called union. That's what I mentioned earlier, the saying that Allah and the universe is one. There are some philosophers last time, they believe that Allah, God and the universe and it is the same. That the universe and it is God. Some philosophers and it, last time they believe in this union. That they are one. Which is when two things and it becomes one, is disbelief as well. Meaning, if you believe it's in indwelling and union, a person, a'udhubillah min dhalik, becomes a disbeliever. Either he says that Allah is in something, or he says that Allah is that thing, meaning Allah is the universe, or Allah is this particular thing, then this person and he is a disbeliever. Because he basically, you are saying that Allah is in need and of something else, and Allah does not stand on his own. So this belief, and he will make any person, a'udhubillah min dhalik, into this belief. And then the author quote any poem by Shihabuddin Al-Makari, the author of Idahu Dujunna Fi Aqidati Ahli Sunnah. So this is a poem, and the translation is, do not lend your ear to the view of the Christians, because the Christians and believe in it is indwelling. That's what we mentioned earlier. Or the one who claims indwelling, Hulul. Whether a person who worship the idols and they believe that God is inside the idol. So he said, do not any lend your ear, meaning do not believe and pay attention. That is like the belief in union, ittihad. It is a view of the people of deviance and atheism. The people any of deviance, meaning people who have deviated any from the path of Allah. And the atheist, who does not believe in the existence any of Allah. People any who does not believe in the existence any of Allah. Some people any now they are saying any that Allah does not exist. Then they turn any to the universe. And they believe any in the power any of the universe. That the universe in itself and it possess power. The universe in itself and it possess power. This is the viewpoint any of the atheists. They do not believe in godly intervention of things any that is happening in the universe. They believe any in an independent power of the universe. This is any a view of the atheists, that we make any a person any into disbelief. We believe that everything happens any by Allah. Allah is the one any who created everything into existence, and everything any happens and function by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Universe any has no power, but Allah is the one any who does any everything. Then he said, he is not in need of a determinant. He is not in need of a determinant. So determinant, we mentioned earlier, it is meaning of what? Taksis, mukhassis. Allah is not in need of a mukhassis, and he is the one who specifies him. Because the thing that is specified is only the mumkin. Allah is wajibul wujud, cannot be specified by something else. Had he been in need of that, he will be contingent. If Allah is in need of a mukhassis, then he is contingent, then he is hadith. And this is impossible for Allah. Clear, inshallah? Everybody can understand this statement? And look at what he's saying. Had he been in need of that? Had he been in need of that? That goes back to one, mukhassis. Had Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in need any of a mukhassis, what will be the result? He will be contingent. He will be a contingent being, and this is mustahil. Mustahil and it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The proof in the book that Allah the Exalted is free of needing a locus. Or a determinant is the words of the Exalted, Ya ayyuhan nas antumul fuqara'u ila Allah wallahu wal ghaniyul hamid. Is verse Surah Al-Fatih, verse 15. Ya ayyuhan nas, O mankind, you are all poor unto Allah, and Allah is free of all needs and worthy of all praise. This is the meaning any of the verse, Ya ayyuhan nas antumul fuqara'u ila Allah. Yani it means, Ya ayyuhan nas, all of you are in need any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahu huwal ghaniyul hamid. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yani is not any in need any of anything. Allah yani is not in need any of anything, and he is praiseworthy. Clear, inshallah? Is there any questions any so far? Is there anything that anyone does not understand so far before I continue? Everything clear? Yes. Yeah. No, the person that he worship the idols, it is not necessary any that it is hulul. He believe any in hulul. There are some people who worship any idols. They believe any that God is inside the idols. This is the understanding of hulul, because the meaning of hulul in Arabic language and is something that comes to something else. Something that comes into something is hulul. So if a person is worshipping idols and he believes in it, that God is inside, meaning what you call it, comes into that particular idol, that particular stone or that particular wood, we say that this belief is hulu. But there are some people who worship idols, they believe that idols and is God. For example, there are people who do not believe in hulul. Even people who worship idols, so they have madhab, meaning they have differences. What you call it? There are some people who worship idols, they believe that this particular idol has power. For example, there are people who worship idols, they believe that the idols have no power. But why are you worshipping any of the idols? Because they believe at the point of worship, God comes in. Inside. So I'm not worshipping the idols, but I'm worshipping beyond the idol. So some people might be saying to you, if you meet people who worship idols, you can ask them, what is their belief? You will find, maybe they have different belief. You find different belief. And from all across the religion, what you call it, you find some people believe in hulul, some people does not believe in hulul. And some people worship idols and they do not believe in the existence of God. Do not be surprised. There are some religion and you find, you go into the temples, they are idols. But they do not believe in the existence any of God. Because they themselves say that we do not know who is God. But we assume that by worshipping this particular idol, our needs will be fulfilled. For example, so this is another understanding. So people have many kinds of beliefs and understanding. So hulul is part of it. There are some people who believe in Ittihad. There are some people who do not believe in Ittihad. There are people who say God is everywhere. The universe is God. There are people who say Al-Kaw is God, for example. So this is what you call it, this belief of Al-Ittihad. Now we continue, inshallah. We have a few more minutes. The proof from the Sunnah is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his statement, "O Allah, there is no God but You, the One free of all need." This hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the Prophet said, "Ya Allah, there is no God any but You, la ilaha illa anta, the One free any of all need." And Allah subhanahu wa taala, is not in need of anything. But other than Allah subhanahu wa taala, is in need of Allah subhanahu wa taala. The Ummah is in agreement that Allah is self-subsistent. This is another ijma. You say there is a ijma. So this is important. Today when you study Tawheed, study Aqidah, when the scholars of Tawheed say that this is ijma, you have to pay attention because there is no khilaf. So you cannot be saying, but there is a khilaf, there is a difference, this particular person is saying this. When there is ijma, khalas. Ijma in Aqidah is something that is agreed upon. Meaning anyone who go against the ijma, it is dangerous. It can make a person go into apostasy if in tawheed, in aqidah. In fiqh, it becomes a fasiq. In fiqh. Even in fiqh, if you go against the ijma, it can make a person becomes a fasiq. At times, it can make a person become an apostate. For example, in fiqh, we have the issue of wiping on the khuf. You will find Al-Imam Tahawi in Aqidah Tahawiyah. He spoke about wiping on the khuf. He said that those who does not believe that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wipe any on his khuf, it is feared that he becomes an apostate. Why? Because this act of wiping any on the khuf is mutawatir. 70 sahaba narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. 70 companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam witness that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do a particular thing. So there is ijma' al-ulama pertaining to this particular act, even though it is in fiqh, wiping on the khuf. But because it is mutawatir, it is something that is established, and there is ijma', and it's a very strong evidence that if a Muslim deny this, then it can make a person an apostate. Imagine this is in fiqh. What if it's in aqidah? When it comes to the attribution of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the scholars mentioned that all Muslims say ijma, the Ahlul Sunnah, every one of them is ijma, that Allah is not in need of something, then to say that Allah is in need of a particular thing, then you are going against ijma. If you go against ijma, if you are lucky, in some cases, there are differences, whether this particular person is apostate or not apostate. But here, the scholar is saying, to go against this particular sifa, this particular, what you call it, thing of qiyamu binafs, to say that Allah is in need of particular thing, you are going against an ijma, and it can lead a person into a disbelief and apostasy. So these are the things that we have to be, that we have to be careful. Today we are in need to learn any our deen, and we are in need any to be careful. Avoid any ignorance, because ignorance any will lead any person any into what you call it, into disbelief if he's not careful. So that is why seeking knowledge, especially in these times of fitna. In akhir zaman, our scholars any mentioned to seek knowledge any is more virtuous any than to perform any acts of ibadah, sunnah ibadah. Because why? Because of the situation. The situation where there's a lot of confusion, there's a lot any of false ideologies, there's a lot of all things any happening. And we can get information any very fast any from YouTube, from all this any social media. Daily we are reading any a lot of things any our mind any is a lot of information any is flooding any into our mind. So we need any something any to differentiate between the truth and the falsehood. And you can only do so by having the possessing knowledge. Without knowledge, any everything comes in. Everything, any if you accept, there will be a problem, because you might be accepting any something any that is will be destructive any to your faith, and you do not know why, because of ignorance. When there is ignorance, and you cannot differentiate what is the truth and what is the falsehood. But when you have knowledge, inshallah, you will be protected. That is why seeking knowledge in akhir zaman, ya jamaah. We have the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What did the Prophet say? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he mentioned that in akhir zaman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take away the ulama. Inna Allah yantazi'u al-ilma inna Allah la yantazi'u ilman intizan walakin intaza'ahu biqabdi al-ulama. Aw kama qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yani Allah will not lift knowledge like that, but Allah yani will lift any knowledge by the passing away of scholars. When the ulama yani pass away, will come in the ignorant ones, and they will give fatwa, or they will be they are the ones any who speak any about religion. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned fadallu wa adallu, they are astray and they make others any astray. This is happening when not in the time of the sahaba, not in the time of the tabi'in. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is speaking about akhir zaman. Now it is time when we are living in. So that is why we are in need and need to seek knowledge, and it's very important. We are in need and need to seek the proper knowledge and to protect any ourselves and our family members. Because any the situation any such, the dangers any of that, that we have to be careful. And the rewards Allah give to us in akhir zaman in seeking knowledge is much more than the rewards of those people last time. And the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi mentioned Allah and he will give one what a person who does a particular act, he will receive 50 times any more rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the sahaba asked any 50 any from them or from us, ya Rasulullah. The Prophet said, minkum, any from you. Yani one person any who performs a particular act in akhir zaman, Allah will give 50 times the rewards of the sahaba. The sahaba does a particular act, a person in akhir zaman, the person in akhir zaman will receive 50 times more. So the sahaba asks, any why ya Rasulullah? It is because any of fitan, because they are obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a situation where it is difficult any upon them. Difficult because they are facing any all these challenges. Like today, any we are facing these challenges. Maybe you are in Singapore, you cannot feel this. But look what is happening in Syria. What is happening in some countries? People have difficulty going out of their houses and to attend majalis ilm. People have the fear even to go to the masjid. In Singapore, we do not feel this. But look at some countries in the Middle East. What's happening? What's happening in China now? What is happening in some parts of India? We have to look. Look at the state of the Muslims. What is happening in Sudan right now, South Sudan? What is happening in Eritrea? Nobody knows, because all these things doesn't come out in the news. Correct or not? But if you find out what is happening to the Muslims in some parts of the world, then you can understand what you call it, the extent of the problems that some Muslims are facing, like in Myanmar and all these places. So it is important also for us any Muslims, for us any to look at the people any who are in this situation, so that we make shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise any we keep on complaining. Even today we complain about the food any that we have, complain any about the drink, or complaining about our houses, but we do not know actually the ni'mah of Allah is huge any upon us. Allah gives you any a lot of ni'mah. How many people do not have houses any today? Millions of people are displaced in Syria. Millions any. We are not speaking about 100 people, 200. In Yemen any right now, you cannot believe it was happening in Yemen. Millions of people in starvation. They do not have food. But we do not know about this. Because we didn't see any of this. Or we didn't hear about this. But if you know people who are living in Yemen right now, you know people who are living in Sana'a, people who are living in Hudaydah right now, if you speak to them, then you can listen to what they're saying. They are having any great difficulties financially, economically. There is a famine, killings, murder, a lot of things, these things are happening. So we must make shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the things that we also make shukr to Allah is the ability to seek knowledge. Today we might be seeking knowledge, tomorrow we might not be seeking knowledge because we don't know what is going to happen. That is why we have to take opportunities. The opportunities today we have any to seize the opportunity because tomorrow we do not know what happens. We are living any in a world where things any can change any at the slightest any moment. Today any a person is rich and tomorrow is poor. Today is poor, next day is rich. Today a person has house, tomorrow no house. These things any are happening any in the world. If you open our eyes, we will find the fitness any that is occurring in some part of the world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect this country and may Allah bless us any with peace and tranquility. And peace and tranquility is very important in societies. That is why Islam always establishes peace. Wherever there is Islam, there is a need to establish peace. You know why? If there is no peace, it's very difficult to practice the deen. That is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he does hijrah to Medina, he established peace with the Yahud, even the Jews. He established any peace between Khazraj, Aus and Khazraj. We've been fighting for years. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came into Medina, the first thing he do is peace treaty. So that people don't fight. So that people live in harmony. And this is important. Because the moment you have peace, tranquility, harmony, no fighting, you can go out to work, you can, what you call it, go to the masjid, you can seek knowledge, you can perform in your obligations, everything is easy. But the moment in this war, what happens? People are displaced, there is no justice, there is robbing, and this all these things are happening. So that is why it is important for us Muslims to understand and to cherish any of the opportunities that you have today. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with tawfiq and hidayah. So this is the closing of our class. I actually don't intend to speak about all this. But alhamdulillah, I spoke. So, in time it is nearly 10 o'clock, so I have to stop. Inshallah, we will continue next week, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us with istiqamah in seeking knowledge. But before we close, is there any questions in this so far? No questions, huh? So if there's no questions, then you close and leave.